The following program may contain language of an adult nature. Listener discretion is advised.
Views and opinions expressed on the following program are those of the hosts and guests, and not necessarily those of the staff or management of AllTalkRadio.net.
We are Anonymous, and you're listening to Maxwell Silverhammer.
Fuck that guy.
And DJ Drickman.
Yeah, fuck that guy too.
Only on STEM Radio.
Damn, this shit really hurts me.
Oh man, hold on, wait a minute. This is some bullshit.
They're canceling the fucking show?
Yeah, they're planning to drop us after 7 years.
That's bullshit. Still got people listening and like the show.
Well, guys, you had a good 7-year run. What more do you want from us?
You're like a goddamn Oreo cookie. It tastes like shit, but swathed in the center.
Okay, goddammit. Our hands are tied, okay? Yeah, you're goddamn right your hands are tied. Jerk and pass me the duct tape, motherfucker. Hey, oh, wait a minute. What are you doing? Tape them together. Yeah, motherfucker.
You know what? I think I kind of like this.
Yeah.
Tie it a little tighter.
Oh.
Tighter? Tighter?
Yeah.
Maxwell Silverhammer, G.J. Jerkman, Cruise Control, and G. Motors.
Hellfire. I think somebody lit a cigarette. Nope, it's the hottest radio show on the internet. So keep it locked here from 7 to 9.
This is still radio fam.
They ahead of their time. And now it's lesson one, man. This is lesson two. No format because they keep it fresh and new. And this is what I call a real show. They tough as hell with a hard edge like a steel tough. They campaign like a basic. So if you're mad at them, call in. Fuck some hate mail. And if you think that the jocks sound quirky, allow me to introduce you to the shit that hurts.
Alright, you sons of fucking bitches. Welcome to the shit that fucking cocksucking irks me. I'm Maxwell Silverhammer, and
I would be GJ Jerkman when I get my microphone on there.
There you go. Now your mic's working.
I'm mic'd up.
And in the building, we got the Flatliners. We got Gravedigger.
Yes, sir.
And Red Rum, I think.
Red Rum, the dude from the slum.
Oh, man. And finally, Tempest. So, what's going on, guys?
What's good, man? What's good? We in the building, Flatline Magic.
I want to start out by saying something.
The team.
You guys did a great.
What's up?
You guys did
That's
a great job.
Directed, boy.
Hey, man. You guys did a great job on the logo thing there. Totally cool.
The dead, man.
Can you hear Jerkman?
Can you guys hear me?
Yeah, we can hear you.
All right, cool. You guys, yeah, I just want to tell you guys. You guys did a great job on that logo. I used it and put it up all over the place. Cool job.
Well, thanks, man. I appreciate it, man.
He loved the logo.
He actually got it tattooed. Our whole gang got it tattooed.
Man.
Flatline sign. Everybody got it.
Flatliners.
I love it.
Well,
cool.
I've got a question. Where have you guys been for 20 years, man?
That's the million-dollar question everybody's been asking. Chilling. So let's start off with you, Dig. Where you been, Dig? Go ahead, tell everybody.
Well, we're going to keep it like this from the beginning at the Flatliners came out in 94. We kind of stepped away for a little bit. You know, it was multiple reasons that we stepped away, but one was Def Jam didn't really have a way to promote what we was doing at the time. It was a way, but they didn't really know. You know, not to knock Def Jam or whatever, but you know, they was doing something different.
Right.
And you know, so it's not like it was. It's not like it is now where we have all these internet stations and you know, satellite radio and Facebook and all this shit where you can promote yourself and do what you got to do and, you know, get you a team and just work your stuff. You had to really rely back then on radios and your videos. And a lot of radio stations was, you know, it was, you know, when black market was trying to push our stuff.
It's the death of playing our music.
The death,
I bet.
The Flatliners was rocking. So, you know, kind of threw us for a curve. Go ahead, bro.
In my opinion, you know what I'm saying, it's similar to what Dick said, you know what I'm saying, with Def Jam, they were trying to promote us to a market that is pretty much Bible Belt. You know what I'm saying? They didn't promote us to the market that I felt we should have been promoted towards, which is the heavy metal rock, the rock road. They tried to promote us to black people. Black people are very religious and superstitious.
Right.
A lot of them sometimes. So for that reason, things didn't work out. Another reason why I'm not gonna say it didn't work out. It just didn't work out how we envisioned it would work out. I mean, but hey, 20 years later, we're still the legends. So
right.
Did it work out? I don't know. I guess maybe it did.
That's funny too, because rock. It was very taboo back then for black people to even dabble around heavy metal or rock or anything. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. It definitely was. It's just a different vibration. You know what I'm saying? Black people are not accustomed to that vibration.
Hmm.
You know, just as crazy as a person who listens to heavy metal and rock listen to African music from Nigeria. You know what I'm saying? Like two different types of vibes. But with that said, though, another reason why we kind of fell back a little bit, because on another end of it, it was just kind of, me particularly, I felt I was being dragged deep into something that I didn't know if I was going to be able to return from. Hmm. So particularly me, you know what I'm saying? So
when you say that, what do you mean deep, something you couldn't return from, as far as like what you were talking about?
As far as when you talk about occult things, and when you study occult things and your videos have occult imagery, you're studying the occult, and you're calling the occult upon you. You know what I'm saying? You're calling spirits upon you, and you're calling these different energies upon you. So that has results. You know what I'm saying? I kind of looked at it as like going out to the ocean. You know what I'm saying? When I was young, I used to like to go swimming way deep out in the ocean. So until one day I swam out so far deep, and the ocean would help me swim out. You know what I'm saying? I swam so far, then I started trying to come back. And the ocean now was not helping me. It was pushing against me. And I thought I was going to drown. I almost drowned. But there's so many people on the beach, I ain't want to scream. You look like a bitch. So I didn't. You know what I'm saying? But luckily, I floated back. You know what I'm saying? I turned on my back and floated back. But I almost drowned. But I look at our experience like that. We was going out deep into the ocean.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? And if we would have continued going out there, we would have drowned. You know what I'm saying? So basically, we was just becoming the unbalanced in disagreeableness or negativity or whatever you want to call that vibe. We was kind of going there.
So tempting fate a little bit then, huh? Sort of. You kind of saw it as kind of like tempting fate, maybe?
I wouldn't say tempting fate. I would just say that accumulating a vibe, you know what I'm saying? Accumulating a frequency that you want.
Right.
And if you're in that frequency, then things of that frequency come to you and can happen to you. If you're talking about murder and death and killing and all that other shit, then you're going to call that upon yourself. You know what I'm saying?
Right, right. Well, that's an interesting point.
Or,
so
if you're talking about demons, you're going to call demons upon yourself. They do exist.
Hmm. So, you know? So having said that, then, will the new Flatliners music be different as far as you're not covering the occult topics anymore or covering, you know, like Satan worship and things like that? What's the new stuff going to be like?
Well, the old stuff was we covered those topics, and the new stuff is we're going to still be covering those topics, but it's just from a different perspective. The perspective of a teenager is different than the perspective of learned gentlemen who've had time to experience experience life a little bit more and had time to calm down a little bit and is not running around here risking our life every 5 minutes, hence the name Flatliners.
Right, right.
People who play with life and death, you know what I'm saying, which is what we did as in our youth, you know what I'm saying? I mean, a lot of us are dead. Many of us are in jail, you know what I'm saying? So life was tempted. Luckily, us three, Dick just got out of jail for five years.
Oh, shit. Yeah. Wow.
You know what I'm saying? He just came home last year.
Oh, you know man.
So
different, totally
that,
different.
That accounts for 5 of the years of the 20 years.
Different perspective, totally, then, man, because obviously jail will change your mindset. You know what I'm saying?
I mean, that's one thing. Having kids will change your mindset.
Yeah.
I used to ain't give a fuck about nothing. I had a son, and now all of a sudden, might want to live. Might not hang out in so many graveyards.
Right, right. Well, I know you guys, in one interview, you compared yourselves to the Jackasses of horrorcore.
Yeah, you know, back in the day,
we, that's
what we kind of, it was like a, we used to say a flat line was like a dare. We would do daring things, and we would say, all right, you got to do a flat line. We would stand in front of the train and make it stop, or we would ride the top of the train or run through traffic. We called that a flat line.
No, dude, keep it 100, dude. We ain't never ride on top of the train.
However,
let's just clarify that right there. We never rode on top of the train. We rode in between the train or in the front of the train or in the back of the train, outside of the train. We've done that. We rode on the doors of the train while it's in the bus. We've done that.
I was just saying, you know, it was.
We have surfed on top of buses, city buses before.
Oh, shit.
We used to bus surf. It started out on the back of the bus. They have a grate. So we used to run and grab, jump on the back of the bus, ride the bus on the back. But then we realized that if you crawl up a little bit, they have something at the top that you could grab your hand on and then pull yourself up. Now you're on top of the bus. So we used to bus surf is one of the things we used to do.
Yeah.
We used to play chicken with cars and trains. We started playing chicken with the train. We started taking pictures on the third rail because I don't know if you'll know, the third rail is the rail that's in between, the middle rail.
You get
so
electrocuted.
You stand on the top joint and take a picture and not get electrocuted.
Don't try to learn this shit at home, man.
Yeah.
You do it as young,
like I said,
crazy
motherfuckers. When I said we jackasses are hardcore, I meant that. You know what I'm saying? Not the dude's jackass. I'm talking about we was jackasses.
But you never shot fireworks up your ass or any weird shit like that, like they did, right?
Nah, man. Now, we ain't doing no gay shit, man. No gay shit, man. To my knowledge, ain't no person in FLM playing with their ass, you know? To my knowledge. You know what I'm saying? I'm pretty sure that nobody in my clique was doing fireworks out their ass.
Well, you know... Here's my experience. This is what was weird because, you know, at the time when I heard of you guys, I'll be honest, man, I kind of slept on your music for a while because, you know, this obviously was before the internet and I was into a lot of, you know, Esham, Gangsta Nip, Brother Lynch Hung, you know, those kind of guys. And then
shout
I heard
out to those guys, man. I loved them.
Oh, yeah. So you were aware of their music, you know, kind of when you guys were coming up doing what you were doing.
Oh, yeah, man. Yeah, we're definitely aware of anybody with horror-themed music or anybody who would touch some of horrorcore. Like, you might have some people who just did horror-sounding beats but rhymed about regular stuff that regular rappers rhyme about. Or you might have a dude who did regular beats who did horror type of rhymes. Then you might have a dude who was about some occult type strange weird shit. Then you might have a dude that's about cutting people's heads off,
right,
style, you know. He was a different torture rap, and you know what I'm saying? So this is all different types of shit. Me particularly, I'm not into all of that torture rap or kill your baby mama and all of that shit. I ain't with all that, you know what I'm saying? Personally, me, you know what I'm saying?
Right.
I'm more into studying of the occult information and the occult knowledge, you know what I'm saying? And teaching those or trying to expose this to those who do not know, because society uses this occult information against you and you have no knowledge of that. So that's more along the lines of where I come from with this.
Man, yeah, it was crazy because, like I said, I heard of you, you know, I think it was Prince De Jour from Rap City. Remember him? The one with the weird hair?
Dude.
And he was talking about you guys. you guys and Gravediggers were the big ones. And I was like, man, what kind of shit is this, man? This is some commercialized shit, whatever. And it wasn't until a couple years later, man, when I actually sat down and listened to some of your shit, and then I was like, oh, wait a minute. They actually were coming at it from a whole different perspective. So it took me a while, man. I can't just say that I was this fan from back in the day that always loved your shit. You know, it took me a minute to really warm up to it. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Well, you know us black hardcore rappers, man. We stereotype, man.
Well, like I said, I did like Gangsta Nip. I did like Esham, but it was just, you know, or Insane Poetry, a lot of those guys, but it was just because it was.
I like Insane Poetry.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
I like his work.
Well, because, you know, it was something that was being talked about. If it was being talked about on Rap City, I guess my mindset was, well, it's got to be commercial.
Yeah. You know? How hardcore could it be?
Right.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah,
but
real.
That's one of our claims to fame is the fact that, you know what I'm saying, we're a hardcore group, and then because we were signed to Def Jam, we kind of helped give the genre, well, first of all, we gave the genre a name, you know what I'm saying?
Right.
Everybody can say what they want, but we called it hardcore first, you know what I'm saying? I specifically recall me and Dig and Temp sitting down and coming up with a name for our style, which was horror music and themes mixed and imagery mixed with hardcore hip-hop. Hardcore. You know what I'm saying?
Cool.
So as far as acid rap and all of and the other forms of things that were similar to what we were doing, you know what I'm saying? We don't claim any of that stuff, but
right.
As far as hardcore, we created that.
Man,
so,
that's Well, you know, and they kind of lumped you in with Gravediggers, too. I mean, were you guys, did you guys ever play shows together, or were you kind of tight with those dudes, or not really?
No, we had
run-ins with them.
One of our affiliates, Omen 999, he was at one point down with the Gravediggers.
Ah.
When we, you know, once we wasn't around, once we, you know, was out the picture, he linked up with the Gravediggers. He went out and do shows and toured with them all over the world as a flatliner with the Gravediggers.
About the Gravediggers, too, is I like the Gravediggers. You know what I'm saying? I truly did like the first single that came out with the first album was nice. I liked it. And then later on, we started doing work with Grim and Poetic, you know what I'm saying? But basically how I looked at the Gravediggers was, the Gravediggers was a Wu-Tang Clan member, two Stetsasonic members, and some other dude.
I think it was Prince Paul or somebody. Maybe,
who are we? I was never anybody other than Rev Rum. Rev Rum is who I am.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Tomorrow I'm not going to be Jamel Pippi Stockings. You know what I'm saying? I'm Red Rum. You know what I'm saying? That's who I came in here with. This is who I am. Only the other name that you're going to hear from me is my government name, Jamel Simmons. But other than that, I'm Red Rum. I'm not somebody else before that and then say, oh, no, let me be hardcore today. You know what I'm saying?
Gotcha. That's
no disrespect to them, but there was other things before that. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
There was Stetsasonic and there was Wu-Tang.
And then it was the Daisy Age, De La Soul, Prince Paul was
exactly.
De La Soul and those guys, too.
Yeah, that's right. Because it was. So I know what you're saying, though.
I never really looked at the Gravediggers as like really hardcore like that. They got attributed some of it because the RZA jumped on. He had already taken martial arts themes and mixed it with hip hop, and he seen that we were taking horror themes and mixing with hip hop, and that could have possibly been the very next. It's a large market. You look how long, how much they got out of the martial arts imagery and world. So it was only natural and right to go to explore into the horror world as well, see what could be made from over there. But I was never mad at them because, as my Uncle Russell said, it just makes the genre bigger,
right?
Instead of it's just us. You know what I'm saying? It makes the genre bigger. At that time, there was other rappers, but nobody was claiming hardcore.
Well, Roman, being that your uncle is Russell Simmons, you know, was there a point where he was like, hey, man, can you guys sort of tone it down? Or, you know, was he a little bit scared of what you were doing?
No, he was on board with what we was trying to do, man. He was on deck. We came with ideas, and he was rolling with our ideas.
He was right. Turn it up. Shout out to Uncle Russell. By the way, man, I just want to set the record straight, man. AllHipHop.com is some fucking faggots, man. It's fucked up what they did. I don't appreciate it. Taking my words from the last interview and then reconstructing it and putting my uncle's picture next to it to make an article that says Russell Simmons' nephew alleges gay cult-like rituals at Def Jam.
Oh, wow.
That's fucked up.
You know damn.
I mean? Yeah, that recently happened.
That's
fucked up. And it was their cover page for 3 days.
Man, so you just
getting back to the question. Russell was like, "Turn up." He wanted us to actually do a little bit more, and that's why if you see our videos was like over the top.
Absolutely,
we went all the way with it. Actually, we went all the way with it. You know, we didn't just hit the surface. We just went all the way with it
because a lot of people didn't know about our album USA. Like, if you bought the tape or if you had the record, not the CD that we had, it was two sides. It was the live side and the evil side. So it was a side that was a little more street than it was a side that was a little more horror.
Mm.
So
it was a side that was street and wild and onyxy, and then there was a side that was dark and...
So once other guys tried to...
Contemplative.
Once guys dropped their horror records or whatever they was doing before we came out, then... They was like, all right, we're going to go here. We're going to take it to this side. And it was strictly the horror side, the deep horror side. We never got a chance to really show the other side, too.
Right. Because everybody was more stuck on the horror music you were doing, so they weren't really listening to the street side as much.
And then here's another thing that's going on, too. All right, you got what we doing and who we are, but then you also have the influence of the major label and what they want and what they want to do and what they want to portray and show, which is everything because they pay the bills. And if there's something that they don't want, they're not paying the bills for that. So everybody in the world should understand that when they look at any artist out here in the world that's paid for by a major label, the major label is not funding or paying for anything for the artist unless it's what the label wants. The artist does not have any creative control. They might tell you that you have creative control, but the truth of the matter is, do you really have creative control if they won't fund your project?
Right. Fitting the bill, so you know
they say, okay, well, you can have 50% creative control, but we're just not going to pay for it.
Or they'll pay for the project. You have creative control, 50%. We'll pay for the project, but guess what? We don't like the content, so we're going to shelf you, and we're going to put it out. Or we're going to release date. Or we play it. That's the game they play.
So, but again, they have their purpose and reasoning, and it's not about money, and it's not about making money. Money is just a precursor to move people spiritually. So they have their spiritual motivation to why they want to show and what they want to show, when they want to show it. So that is, you have to include that as well as our intentions. Which, if our intentions align with their intentions, then it's all good. It's a go-ahead. If our intentions don't align with their intentions, it's not a go-ahead. So towards the end of our album, our intentions were not aligning with their intentions.
So which is strange, though, because obviously your uncle was the CEO of the label. So who was throwing up these roadblocks so you guys couldn't really do what you needed to do?
Well, I'm just going to say that things are a little... First of all, you know what I'm saying? He did not deal in day-to-day operations of running the company. He doesn't do that. You know, he didn't do that for many, many years, especially towards when we were there. You know what I'm saying? They had a big structure. It was already a corporate entity by then. It wasn't a little Def Jam that they made in the college joint where he sat there and made, you know, he's sitting on the record and I want to sit here in the studio while I was being, there was none of that, you know what I'm saying, with him. He was a mogul by that time. So, you know what I'm saying? Nothing to do with that. So now we're just dealing with the corporate structure and the corporate entity. What do they want? You know what I'm saying?
Okay,
so they want to rule the fucking world. Mm. They want to rule the world through rap.
You know what else? Not only that, it's a business also. You got to look at it as a business at the end of the day. Yeah, we family, but it's a business. And then there's corporations that run the business. So,
well, the family should have nothing to do with nothing. There was no nepotism. You know what I'm saying? Everybody look at that and say, oh, y'all got signed to Def Jam because, nah, we got signed to Def Jam because we was promoting the theme that they wanted to promote. They didn't even want to really sign us at first. Or Uncle Russell didn't even think about me. He laughed at me, as he often do. You know what I'm saying? He laughed at me when I came with the flatline of music. And he stopped laughing when Jam Master Jay signed us after Jam Master Jay just finished having platinum success with Onyx. Jam after Jay signed us and was promoting us alongside of Onyx. So then after that, we were no longer a game to be played with now. Uncle Russell said, hey, nephew, why you come over here with your family? You know what I'm saying? And, you know, he's my uncle, so I did. You know what I mean?
Oh, wow. So.
Every time I say I'm talking about us.
Right.
You know what I'm saying?
Three of you.
We brothers. So every time they say I, they're talking about me, and every time I say I'm talking about them. So every move that we've ever made has been together. So basically, you know what I'm saying? Understand that.
That's
signing straight to Def. They're not signing nowhere else but straight Def Jam, period.
How I'm telling my uncle no.
Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? And not only that, that's Def Jam. Why, you know what I'm saying? We looked at it like, that's Def Jam. That's iconic right there.
Another thing I would like to make clear, too, is that before Flatliners, Digga and Tempest was my brother, so they was already part of my family. So, you know what I'm saying? Again, when I say I and Uncle Russell, they're included in that as well because we was all together.
Right,
so,
right.
You know.
Man. Well, you know, actually, I want to jump into one of your tracks real quick. What do we got over there first, Jerkman? Let's see. Body in a Blunt. All right, so we're going to jump into Body in a Blunt.
Yeah, that's an unreleased joint. That was a joint that never came out on the album, which we liked, but it was, you know, we had to sit down at the table and see which one was out. And that was one of the ones that was out, which was a great song produced by DJ Sage, I think, did that song. Am I right, Tim?
DJ Sage.
My boy DJ Sage, he did that track right there.
Well, we're going to jump into that real quick, and then we're going to come back and talk to you guys some more, so hang on with us.
Yeah. Born in the blunt. Yeah, 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 yeah. Born in shorty. That's when I get naughty. Everybody look critical like I was Barry Gordy. So tap the bottle, I twist the cap, I'm strapped. I bust a cap for awesome, blow a nigga off the map. Bust a crack, the OE niggas flock like birds. Getting pissy drunk and burping like Revenge of the Nerd. Snaggering over chairs, knocking over bitches. Waiting for niggas the front day, dreaming about the ditches. Let's investigate what's going on inside of a bottle. Stay in trouble, I throttle, hold the 40 like a throttle. When beat breaks out, I use the 40 for a weapon. And crack a nigga over his dome and keep on stepping. The best thing in this world is making a nigga run, puffing a bun and ripping a skirt up a 40, girl. I'm in the mad murdering realm for drinking. We crashed a Lincoln, he had the chuck, so now I'm thinking what I want. 40 in the front, that's what she meant. So what you want? 40 in the front. Watch you shiver. I mutilate your body and deliver razor cuts to your guts. Violate your tombs and hell blood fumes. Spirits I consume from the underground rooms. The devil's in me, so I guess I am the enemy. And people should have wondered about what's coming, a friend of me. Drinking down a 40 and smoking the chocolate top. I'm on the rough ride, so you better go inside. Cause I'm the gatekeeper, street sweeper. I dig, digs them deeper. Tip the motherfucking flatline freaker. Drain the ice and drink the blood with the beaker. I never get caught, I keep the vibe on my beeper. Beat the nigga with the voice of choice like SWB. And leave you weak with my intro, so be my love thing. I swing smoke and blood, just steady pumping, huh? I'm not shy, but I can still be your comforter. So pass the 40 in the blood to a stunt. Cause the 40 in the blood, that's what she meant.
Oh, yes, that good old boom bap feel, man. There's just something about that. It just feels good. You know what? We were off the air while we're listening to this. Jerkman came up with, you guys should do a remix called Kicker in the Cunt.
Kicker in the butt.
Kicker in the cunt.
Kicker in the cunt.
Yeah, I think it'd be great, man.
So what you want?
Nah, man, I'm trying to slide up in some cunt, man. I ain't trying to kick no cunt.
Kicker in the cunt.
That was
kicker in the cunt.
No, man, we want to. The cunt is valuable.
I want to stick in the cunt.
Well, as Kumo said, though, as it may turn into a foot extended from the middle of your body. And if you do, what did he say? And next time you see a hottie, you won't be able to screw. You just kick her. So go take karate. That's if she gives you the drips.
Kick her in the gut. That's crazy.
Well, you know,
I can't say I've ever done that.
About a bitch you're trying to get rid of, you know what I'm saying? So,
about a bitch you trying to get rid of.
Oh, yeah.
I kicked it to the curb. I never kicked it to the cunt before. Kick it to the cunt, then the curb.
So that track was not on the USA album?
No, that's not on it.
Hmm.
Well, we have an unreleased album that we selling that right now. The 20th anniversary unreleased songs on it. That song is on there. We selling it on our website. The official.
We got 7 unreleased joints on there. Some of them is, I mean, all of them is dope, but some of them is my personal favorites, man. Some of the unreleased joints is really, really hard, man. It's really serious too.
Wow. So that's,
you know, riding the blunt was fun and all that shit. But there's some joints on there that's fucking serious, man. And we got some new skits on there too that'll blow your mind.
Oh, the skits are always great. I love skits.
Yeah, yeah.
Rappers should be doing more of those.
Obama skit. That's my favorite.
Oh, man.
Hold on. He talking about for the original album, the skits he talking about.
Oh,
just any skits. I think more rappers should do skits in general. I just like skits, you know? It shows personality.
You gotta have skits, man.
That's
Yeah, exactly. Show personality. Give people some red meat.
But we're going to have some real interesting skits on this album right here.
Man.
You know what we're working on. Real interesting. Oh, yeah.
But the new one we just put out, the remix album, unreleased album we just put out, got a lot of nice skits on it. Got all the old USA songs, you know what I'm saying? And then they got 7 unreleased tracks, and they got 4 new skits on it.
So
interesting skits. Real interesting.
Well, you know, and that's the problem now, too. I think too many rappers, they take themselves too seriously, you know what I'm saying? And they're afraid to have fun, you know what I mean?
Yeah, Flatliners, we always was real, man. We wasn't trying to be too tough. We was ourselves. We wasn't, you know, wasn't going to act too tough to laugh and crack jokes. Because that's what we are. When we amongst each other, we like to have fun. So we wanted to show that on our record.
That's good. That's good.
Oh, yeah, we was fucking fools when we was younger. When we did that, oh, man, we was fucking laugh all fucking day. Fight and laugh all day.
That's all we did.
Rob the weed spot.
Man.
Drink, hang out all night till 3 in the morning.
It's kind of funny,
don't
though.
Don't try that at home, kids. Kids, don't try this at home.
It's kind of funny. I hope no kids are listening to
I'm
this show.
About fight, night fights, gun fights.
Night fights. Kids, don't try that at home. Kids, don't try that at home.
No, but I got a son now, son. He better not fucking be out here hanging out in cemeteries and shit, nigga. Let me find out my son hang out in cemeteries. I'll whip his ass.
what did you guys do at cemeteries, man? What kind of shit were you doing in the cemetery?
The cemetery, and my son in there smoking weed, drinking and shit, man. I thought, man, I fucking have a hard time.
We used to go on tour. We was on tour. We would find a cemetery in a city.
Well, the mother, I swear, every city we used to go. The cemetery shit started because when there's large groups of black dudes hanging together, police come about.
Yeah,
all the time. So we could not hang on the streets with 30 of us. So what we started doing was we would go to deep inside the cemetery. Nobody can see us there. And we just start hanging out in the cemetery. That's where we smoked our weed, drank. We were writing our rhymes in there. I'm keeping
now,
100,
20 years
man.
Later in New York, they stopped the stop.
I know niggas that, you know what I mean? I don't want to tell them myself, man. My girl hit me and some shit, but I done got pussy in the cemetery before. So, you know, just like a fucking movie.
Oh,
like a,
that's great.
Like one of the more horror movies, nigga.
That's great.
Just like one of the more horror movies.
Did
only
any
thing I had was the varsity jacket.
did anything you know? Like really fucked up happen when you were in a cemetery? Like, you ever hear noises or see movement or any weird shit?
Yeah, hell yeah.
Hell yeah.
We the fucking noises. Yeah. All types of crazy shit used to happen.
Yo, the funny shit, man, we used to take some new jacks with us out there and shit. Sometimes we'd be like, yo, you see that shit? And we'd just all haul ass, and they just running for their life and shit. Like,
yeah, I remember that shit, dang. That's what the mama, I remember that shit, dang. Yo, I remember that. I remember you
do that. Take motherfuckers want to be down. We'd take them
up. People be walking by on the street by where the edge of the cemetery is at, you know what I'm saying? And we would be behind tombstones and shit, and people would walk by, we'd just pop out on them and shit.
Oh, wow.
Through there and had a lot of people running.
Hey, yo, the crazy shit, we'd have been taping that shit, man.
That's
crazy. Man. And like a lot of these guys I see now on these little websites and web shows, they got these little skits where they scaring the shit out of people and they jumping out of
my
shit.
My favorite, my nigga, you seen the snowman, nigga. That's my favorite nigga.
I don't think I see the snowman shit.
You gotta see that nigga, son. The snowman, angry snowman, son.
I see the 3 motherfucking thug clowns jump out the car.
Nice, yeah.
Bloody, the whole car bloody.
So that's the shit. You guys just would fuck with people and jump out from behind tombstones and you know, shoot people with fucking squirt guns.
Listen, sir, I'm gonna just tell you something really quick. We used to do funny shit like that, but we used to fuck people up, too. Like, we used to do fucked up shit, too. So y'all niggas is omitting all of that, dude. Y'all omitting all of that. Y'all omitting the fights. Y'all omitting TD and kicking people down. And y'all omitting all of that shit, son. You're omitting bashing people in the head with the bottles. You're omitting cutting people with the razors, dude. Spitting razors. You're omitting it all, man. Can't tell a story about how we was having fun in the graveyard, but then don't tell a story about how we was hurting people and fighting every day. You know what I mean?
You know, it's funny.
Kids, don't try this at home. Kids, do not try this shit at home.
Hey, it's funny, man.
You know, I'm going to keep it real, man. We some wild dudes then growing up.
It's funny. You guys, you called me sir, but I'm sitting here smiling, man.
I'm telling you, it was already gangs out here.
Oh, yeah.
So, you know what I'm saying? It was already gangs. That's why we made the Flatliners. Because it was gangs out here, and then every day, individually, we was dealing with these gangs for, like, fighting them and fighting dudes. And, you know what I'm saying? We had to get together. This happened in junior high school.
Wow. Man.
And, we was too known to follow somebody else's shit.
That as well.
Yeah, we had too much of a crew. We was too deep, so we, like, fuck it. We start our own shit.
Just and we did. And then at one point, we was, like, 100 deep.
Fighting.
Flatliners is not just me digging Tempest. Flatliners is 100 dudes with flatline tattoos on them.
Wow.
You know what I'm saying? Me digging Tempest is just the rappers.
But there was, you know, you had other dudes rolling with you that were just down with you, doing fucked up shit, you know, that would smoke with you.
Us as well. We were the ones trying to do the most fucked up shit because we used the visual aspect. Then there was dudes that was just, you know, there was a lot of crazy killer type dudes.
Yeah, you know, it's always somebody. Shit ain't nobody going. The elevator ain't going to the top floor for real. There's a couple motherfuckers roll with me. You know, the light is on, but nobody home.
A lot of them dudes is locked up right now. You know what I'm saying? FLM.
Yeah.
Man, that's
mean. You know. Love them. But I got a son, man. I ain't fucking with it, man.
So that, you
know, I'm trying to be out here for my boy, man.
But like I said, I had my son back then. It didn't matter.
When you were young, you did.
Yeah. That's, but you know, right
I'm
now.
Wow, my nigga. I still ain't going to let nobody run up on me and punk me or no shit, nigga. I just ain't trying to fucking run up on niggas with guns and all that stupid shit no more, man. I ain't want to go to jail. Boring, dude.
But I'm just saying, I had a son, that shit didn't matter back then. None of that shit mattered back then. Like, now
yeah,
it
back
matters.
Then, you're right. Yeah, you're right. Back then, nothing mattered.
It don't matter. But now we adults now. We grown now. A lot of things matter. We grown. We trying to make this.
Nigga
want to
live.
We trying to put this music out. You know, we trying to make some powerful moves. You got to get on these movie soundtracks. And
I want
to
live.
Get these ill videos put out. Show us, you know, show everybody the new flavor of the Flatliners, man.
Man,
get up in the morning and ride.
Now, you know, I was talking to my boy today, my boy Venom today out in Cali. You know, we making some moves. We trying to get some shit with John Cena, the wrestler. And you know, shout out to him. Shout out to Ronnie Killings, R-Truth. Hey. Shout out to WWE dude that rap, doing horror music.
And wait,
you know, trying to link up some shit with them.
Now, this dude Venom you're talking about, this isn't a white dude, is it?
Nah.
Okay, good. Because I know a white guy named Venom, and I was going to warn you to stay away from that fucker. So this dude.
What'd he do?
This dude, man, what he did, and I've talked about it on the show before, but basically he used to be with a group called Bloodline. And then he stopped being with them. But then he hit me up on Facebook one day and told me, man, you know, I had a really bad year. I really need to talk to you. I need a favor. Anyway, he came with this whole story that he had prostate cancer. And he needed money, and could I send him some money so he could get his treatment? So I did, you know, thinking,
oh. Tell me that the dude lied to you about penis cancer?
Yes, he did. He said he had prostate cancer. And I was like, oh, fuck, you know? So
yeah,
I sent him the money, man.
I ain't never going to lie about penis cancer, nigga. You fuck around. Catch it. Yeah.
That's, hey, hopefully he does really catch it, man, because dude never paid me back, and he was funny about paying me back.
Nah, I don't do that, man. I don't wish penis cancer on my worst enemy, man.
Nah,
So, yeah, that dude is a fucking, if you ever see a dude named Venom, you know, a white guy, and I think he's in Colorado now, but if he ever comes at you, man, run the other way. So, that's all I'm saying.
Definitely will.
motherfucker come out swinging the penis sword at you.
Yeah, swollen penis at your ass.
You know, there's a lot of these new groups, though, man, that have that, like, I guess they call themselves grindcore or something. You know, like dudes like Necro. You ever heard of Necro?
Yeah, I heard Necro.
Yeah, I heard of Necro from out here in New York, ain't he?
Yep, from Brooklyn. So you guys actually, I don't know if, you know, you've ever worked with any of those guys, you know, like Mr. Hyde or Necro or, none of them.
I was talking to the Gore-Tex people. I was thinking about putting something together with him, Gore-Tex.
Oh, yeah.
I think he used to roll with Necro. I don't know if he's still with him.
No.
I've been following with him. You know, we're trying to get some things going with a couple of dudes that's doing their thing, man. Kung Fu Vampire, Twisted, we linked up with those guys. So we're trying to put something together with them. Mr. Gray, Blaze the Day.
Oh.
A couple of guys. Got this artist. Let me see. Omen 999. Mars. Kicked it with Mars a couple of times. Thinking about putting something together with him. A guy named Lex Masters, a hardcore kid out of Queens, New York. Lex Masters, shout out to him.
Man, the thing is too. There's a lot of horrorcore. But it's very saturated, man. A lot of them are just a bunch of angst-filled white kids now, you know what I'm saying, that are just pissed off at everything.
Yeah,
you know?
Right.
Where you guys actually were having fun, you know?
Right, because, you know,
we were just having fun and learning different aspects of life that we ain't privy, you know, as young black kids, we wasn't really too privy to, because it's not a lot of occult topics, you know what I'm saying? People don't talk about demons and spirits and any of that stuff, you know what I'm saying? But it's so related to the hood. Like, for instance, every fucking corner is a store that sells spirits.
Nah.
I mean, it says wines in front, but wines and spirits. Nigga, what that's about? You know what I mean?
Right.
So, basically, you got a store that's selling you bottled spirits, but every day, but you don't know it. You don't know nothing about it. It's made in a gin mill. What's a gin? Gin is an Arabic word for an evil spirit. It's where the word genie come from.
Well, so shit.
A gin mill.
Or even the drugs, man. Like, the certain drugs, man, the certain drugs bring the demon out in somebody, too. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, absolutely. It's an altered consciousness. It's about altered consciousness, and it's about you being drugs and these different alcohol. What it does is it just puts you in a vibration that's in the same vibration as these entities. So now you're able to, they're able to go right into you. It's like a computer program. There's certain computers, Apple, you can't, if you got an Apple computer, you can't fuck with, Windows, you know what I'm saying? You got to have something that's compatible. So if you make something compatible, then that's the same thing. If you make yourself compatible to these entities, then these entities can possess you. What is possession?
Right.
Well, possession is you got different components in you. You know what I'm saying? Everybody got a spirit, a soul, and a body. You know what I'm saying? So a demon could come into you and replace your soul, which is the love that's inside you, or your feelings, and then just have access to your memories and have access to your personality. So you thinking that this person might have it might have the same personality, same memories, but the love is different. It's a different person.
Right.
Even though that entity that's in it, you know what I'm saying? I've been possessed before, so I know what the fuck I'm talking about. I'm not just talking out my ass or some shit I've seen on YouTube. I've been possessed by an entity named Red Rum. I am not him talking to you right now. But the entity Red Rum was a little motherfucker. It wasn't me. You know what I'm saying? I know it wasn't me because he would do things that I would not do. You know what I'm saying? He's just a disagreeable motherfucker.
Hmm.
Do disagreeable things and like doing disagreeable things. I'm not really that. That's the main reason why Flatline has changed for me. You know what I'm saying? I couldn't be that same person, that dude no more. I was being groomed to be him, for him to just control me forever. You know what I'm saying? And I ain't want to deal with that, man.
So you were living
people have no idea of possession.
You were living your microphone. Huh? You were living your character that you were on wax, pretty much, and on the streets.
Well, I'll give you another for instance. You know what I'm saying? I like to use her as an example. But do you believe Nicki Minaj when she says she's possessed by a little boy named Roman and several other entities?
Oh.
Wow. Or do you think she's just playing a fucking game?
I think she's playing a game. Because she's stupid.
She's telling you the honest to God motherfucking truth.
I
believe what she say. Just take that face value when she tell you that she's possessed by a little boy named Roman.
Wow.
Who's evil and gay. And also by his mother and also by several other entities. Believe it.
Yeah, because
this is what is going on in the music industry.
Yeah, they are Illuminati, you know, so yeah, I know what you're saying. They do mess around with a lot of satanic, you know, symbolism and type of shit like that.
Yeah, and this I didn't want to touch on that because that's how these motherfuckers got me laughing. Then tomorrow I'm going to wake up and be a world star.
Oh.
You know what I'm saying?
Well, one thing I will warn you,
prevalent.
We don't edit anything, man. So if don't write me tomorrow and say, man, can you cut this out? We don't do it, man.
It's not that you edited it. It's what happened was we did an interview with a radio station much similar to like yours, and allhiphop.com decided to listen to the interview and report on the interview and to take excerpts from it and then write their own thing. So me and you could sit here and do exactly what we're doing, and then tomorrow I could still wake up and then say some crazy shit.
See, that's like a broad dude. That's kind of fucked up.
No, that's how the blogs do. They take an excerpt and they put probably Russell's face on it.
That's what they did.
So they put his face, then you see our faces, and then they try to twist our words into some bullshit.
Man, and you think being internet media, they try to be honest. You know, that's what we do. That's why we get exactly what you're talking about.
See, what they do is they just take the topic, and just the topic could be fucked up, and then sometimes they'll put the regular words you say, but they made everybody look at that fucked up topic, and now people looking at you crazy just when they read the topic, and then they read the interview and like,
people didn't even listen to the interview.
People didn't even listen to the interview.
Can you repeat that again? We lost that. I'm trying to get the clip. 99%
of the people did not listen to the interview. Yeah. 99% of the people didn't listen to the interview. 99% of the people just
like, we crazy.
looked at the allhiphop.com commentary. That's it. That's all they looked at. They ain't listened to the interview or nothing to see if it was factual what they were saying or nothing.
Wow.
Most people, 99% of the people, they just...
That's...
85% of people are blind, deaf, and dumb.
10%
of the people are fucking evil who use the blind, deaf, and dumb. And then 5% of the people is poor righteous teachers like myself.
That's, you know what, dude, on that note, I want to get into satanic verses, man. We're going to jump into that real quick.
Oh, yeah.
Little quote, man, to jump into a track.
It's the tales of the evil.
We'll be right back.
Of torment when I'm changed, then I become drains, more bitten, more strange. Who dares disturb my slumber, very dumb? Remember you run when red rum comes in Vietnam, you two brains are better than one when one's done for, because of the chainsaw, pain, boy.
was in rainstorms. What he was in, there's no escaping. Can we begin? I'll sing when I'm temptation on the patient. Snakes can raise to death from Bed-Stuy. Shall we paint the whole town red and the skies with bloodshed? Exercise me, please, and release me. I possess my mind's infested and I like it. It's the tales of the evil. It's the tales of the evil. Unite the S-verses. Unite the S-verses. See, last night I couldn't sleep. I kept having nightmares. Somebody's washing the blood off my stained sheets. My cave inhabited by bats and back from the dead cats. A bunch of blood drinking sewer rats. The black coat receives the dagger. Hocus pocus, I'm a good hammer. You cut from your groin to your gullets. Then you're found headless with a flat line. Bodies entwined, you're being hung by barbed wire. What's false? The beginning of the end of an era. The horror, the terror. Unprotected, proper compliments. No nigga, there's no stopping it. Kill a graveyard skill, sucking your soul from your esophagus. A huge, of a natural wild reptile style worm. Took it as a germ. What is the gross term? It's worms. To the death, to the smoke, and the night, and the light misbehaving. When you were slaving, raving, representing a craving. To us, the darkest night for me to represent my identity. All the dirt that were enemies will last into infinity. On a rampage, ripping out of my shirt and out of my flesh. Someone shot me with holy water to wet me out of my nest. But like the red, I react, I spun them around and sliced their faces. And mutilated their bodies and kicked off satanic phrases.
Sucking your soul from your esophagus. God damn. Back on with the Flatliners.
Yes, sir.
Man. That's what was that?
The naughty head gone going.
Man. That was some wild shit. But obviously in 20 years. You guys still got it. You know what I'm saying? Like I heard some of the other tracks you sent that were newer, and you know, I mean, obviously it's not as boom bappy, but you still got that crazy fucked up edge, man.
Yeah, yo, I mean that stuff is old too. A lot of that stuff is stuff that never came out for the first album. There's some of the couple of years after, but all the new shit, man.
That's like
the new shit is gonna be what it is.
Well, that's like the track Like Us. You know, I can tell that's a newer track that you guys had done that fairly recently. You know what I mean? You there? Hello? Oh, shit. Hello?
Hello?
You guys there? Okay. Well, like the track, I was saying like the track Like Us, I could tell that's a newer track that you had done that fairly recently.
Yeah. I think one and two of them are us.
Man, because yeah, that's you know, it definitely has that newer sound to it. It's not as boom bappy, but I love that boom bap type shit, man. That's always been my thing, you know, because it's to me that was high school and college.
Uh-huh.
And then of course they put in G funk. When they were doing, see, that's what was kind of cool when they were throwing G funk at us. Then you guys came out, so you were on a totally different vibe.
Yeah, we wanted to change the whole vibe, man, because everything was on that G-Funk era. And like I said, it was guys, you know, the guys was doing the dark music. That's when we came with the horror. We named it Horrorcore. He was back to Dana Dane. He had nightmares, you know, shit like that was out.
Right.
I grew up in that era listening to music like that.
Right.
So, you know, I know a lot of guys be saying, yo, we did that shit before Flatliners and all. We know it was guys doing something similar. Those guys came out a couple of years before us, but we didn't want to do nothing nowhere near what somebody else was doing. So we changed our flows. We did our music dark and our beats and our you know, the visuals.
Right.
And the whole thing was going to be a hardcore theme, different from what everybody else was doing.
Man.
Damn, man, we might have to go into another track. I think the guys got interrupted.
I was going
to
say, I don't hear the other two guys here, man. What happened to them?
Yeah, so y'all might have to go into another track. I'll get them back on the line and call back in.
Oh, okay. All right, so let's jump into what we got over there, Jerkman. Warzone. All right, this is a good one. We'll jump into Warzone. We'll be right back. Yeah, the war zone.
Oh, I tell you,
the devil walks amongst you. We're back on with the Flatliners. What's going on, guys? You all back in now?
Yeah, we back in. Cool. Back.
Cool, man. So let me ask you this: when Jam Master Jay got killed, man, obviously he was very close to you guys, man. How did that affect you?
Well, who?
Jam Master Jay.
Jam Jay.
Oh, man, yo, I was hurt, man. That was like a big brother, uncle, everything to us, man. We was close.
Yeah, Jay was definitely like an uncle. I called him Uncle Jay, you know what I'm saying? He's definitely one of the most down-to-earth people that you might meet. He's a great dude, man. I mean, besides the legendary status of being Jam Master Jay from the legendary group Run DMC, just as a person, he's a good dude. I'm still good friends with his son, Jitta, you know what I'm saying? Jam Master Jason, you know what I'm saying? He's a DJ now as well, quite a popular DJ at that. Matter of fact, he just DJed from took his father's position and DJed for Run DMC when he did the concert at the Barclays about 2 weeks ago.
Oh wow, wow! Now how did
2 weeks ago, man? That was about 3 months ago.
That wasn't no 3 fucking months ago, was it? Was it?
She was like October, man.
That's what? That's called getting old,
no
man.
Goddamn October. It was December, digga.
It was like December.
A month ago, man. It was December.
In December.
That's for me, October. That means I'm fucking crazy, nigga. It wasn't 2 weeks ago. You're right. It was two months ago.
Oh, okay. Yeah, I thought you were talking about the Def Jam 30 joint.
No.
Yeah. You're right. Yeah, that was my bad.
That's you know what? It's funny. December? That's part of getting old, man. Things seem like they happen very soon, but actually it was months ago. Hell, you know what I'm saying? So
yeah, I got confused with another event. That's what it was.
For me, James J. He was from Queens, so he was one of the realest dudes that you could ever meet. Even though he was legendary, he was humble and down to earth. Yeah, I'm still fucked up behind that. You know what I'm saying? If you may,
can I finish, champ? I ain't gonna cut you off.
Nah, he's just a good person. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. And I'm still, we still like rap in general. The whole game is fucked up behind that because that was a good dude, a really, really good dude.
And he's a mentor too. He taught us a lot.
Yeah,
he taught
us a lot. That's what I was just about to say.
Matter of fact, he's the one who bought it. It wouldn't be no Flatliners without. I mean, it would have been the game, but it would have been no Flatliners rap group without Jam Master J. You know what I'm saying?
Oh wow!
He's definitely the one that showed us interest and cultivated us and pointed us in showed us the different choices of directions to take and allowed us to choose the directions that we wanted. He cultivated us, you know what I'm saying? Taught us how to be great artists, taught us how to do shows really well, you know what I'm saying? Produced for us, he executive produced our album.
Man.
You know what I'm
he believed in the Flatliners first, you know what I'm saying? Like,
that's word up.
Wow. And Kenny Lee was like the biggest Flatliners supporters.
A lot of people don't know Kenny Lee, Russell
Right Hand
Man. My man Kenny Lee, man.
Uncle Kenny, that's my dude, man. The real, real, real dude, son. Gangster nigga.
That's crazy.
Old school, good gangster nigga.
So now when you drop your new shit, man, what? Well, obviously the new album is out, man. It's not on Def Jam, right?
Nah, it's not on Def Jam, right? We're really trying to go independent, man. We're really trying to rock this independent. We want to have full control of what we're trying to do because we want that power and what we're trying to put out to these people right now.
Right.
And, we want full control over what we're doing, man, because I believe in Red Rum, and Red Rum believe in Digga, and Digga believe in Tempest. And, you know, I know we all know what to do and what to bring, and we don't feel that nobody else should be telling us that.
Man.
As far as beats, angles, everything.
So that's, you know, it's just funny, man, because now being at the game is so fucked up, you know, what is even the want to be a rapper now? You know what I'm saying? Like, why would somebody even want to, what made you guys want to jump back into it?
Well, the good thing about it is us being in horrorcore and horrorcore having its own genre now is we are horrorcore and we can do what the fuck we feel horrorcore is because we love this genre. We ain't got to really worry about what mainstream is doing.
Nah.
They pretty much are trying to do what horrorcore is doing. They're tapping into, they're tapping into what they feel horrorcore is.
Well, let me tell you what it is, man. The industry was always trying to do horrorcore. The whole industry. Rap is all just going to be horrorcore one damn day. You know what I'm saying? Because if you look at the artists, everything they're doing is about some horror shit. You know what I'm saying? They talk about killing people. They talk about sex rituals called menage a trois, which is a cult ritual. You know what I'm saying? They talk about murder, death, killing, you name it. You know what I'm saying? Disagreeable shit.
Right.
And the imagery, the occult imagery is there. So, you know what I'm saying? They was just going to be blatant with it with us, but now they're just being a bit more subliminal with it.
Well,
because this is still the same shit. Satanism is still about materialism and greed and wanting another nigga wife and killing your brother.
Yeah,
disrespecting what the nigga said. What the little stupid looking mushroom head nigga.
Go ahead, nobody.
Ray Schmurz. What he said? He said. My mama said I ain't living right.
Hmm.
If you ask my mama, I ain't living right. You know what I'm saying? What kind of shit is that to say, man? You happy that your mama don't think you living right, nigga? That's stupid. You know what I'm saying? But that's Satanism for you. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
Disrespect your parents and disrespect your parents. You know, all these tenets that we talk about in the Bible, thou shalt not covet another man's wife. Every damn song, the rap dude who's rich and famous, he want your girl. You ain't got shit, but he wants your girl. You know what I'm saying? Why? Why you want my girl? Why you don't want another rich girl or somebody that you know what I mean? That's in your league. No, you want my girl.
Right.
Thou shalt not covet another man's wife. You want me to sing your songs and covet another man's wife. You know what I'm saying? Pretty much. And that's what that's about. That's what this is about. That's what occult and Satanism is about.
Well, you know, too, like a lot of the beats, too, man, are very horrorcore-y if you listen to, you know, a lot of, you know, they're kind of dark. You know what I'm saying? It's not really happy-sounding music.
Absolutely. Yeah. Well, like I said, it's all going in a certain direction. I mean, we could sit here and have a real good conversation about the actual construction of the music and how that's related to the occult. You know what I'm saying? That's a whole nother story. I'm talking about the actual beat itself.
Right.
Now, forget the words. The beats themselves are ritualistic and occult, because understand that what we're not listening to a drum. We're listening to a computer that's lying to us and telling us it sounded like a drum. It's not a drum, though. It's a computer. It's a different vibration than earth music. A drum is made from the skin of... It's made from earth materials, made from wood and from the skin of animals. All musical instruments are made from earth materials. But what we're listening to today is not music. It's computer. It's computers that sound like music. It's a computer that sounds like a guitar. A guitar is some wood shit with some strings on it.
Right.
You know what I mean? Earth materials. You know what I'm saying? A flute. Or that's why they call it the winds. A flute have, you know what I'm saying, is made out of wood and uses the wind, you know what I'm saying, but not shit on the computer. The first computer was, the first music computer was called Pan. And today we still Pan music. Who is Pan? You know what I'm saying? We know that Pan was the half man, half goat god of music. You know what I'm saying? But anyway,
that's
a lot of stuff inside what we listen to.
That was deep, man.
Let me get back to your question of why we want to jump back in it.
Yeah, yeah.
Right now, you got the where we got the direct connect to the fans. If you follow us on Instagram, Twitter, our Facebook, you're speaking directly to one of us, or you could be speaking to three of us. But we on there, and we got that direct connect to the fans. The love that they showing us worldwide. Why not give them more of the Flatliners? And that's what one of the decisions that we made to jump back in is because. One, we didn't like the representation of where we went with the first album, and then we kind of shortchanged them because we only gave them a little bit of it. So now we formed again, and then it just spread like wildfire, and then it's kind of like the fans have been requesting us. They've been looking for us, too. So now the internet is there, so it just makes perfect sense.
Yeah.
Actually, that's a very – I like that answer, man. Because you're right, you do have direct access to your fans.
Poetry.
Yeah, that's right. About right.
That blew my mind, man, when I seen a kid in Paris at the Flatline Shrine in his living room. He threw the picture up, and he got the picture on his wall of the Flatliners, and he got a shrine in his living room with skulls and shit and pictures of us. And I'm like, wow. You know, I got to give him more.
I get a text from France. From all over the place, from different people, they inbox me and be like, you know what, Tempest, just have a good day. You know, stuff like that make me want to go in here and go hard for them because, you know what, actually at the end of the day, they took time out to check in on the Flatliners. So why not give them something?
You know, these guys, you know, they love horror. They love horror music. You know what I'm saying? You know, we love horror music. They love it. We like horror movies. You know, we want to share that with everybody, man.
That's a great answer. I like the answer, man. That's perfect.
All right, well, listen.
Still trying to figure out how I feel about a grown man with a shrine of me somewhere on the other side of the world.
Well, listen. You know what?
That's a real answer.
That's a real answer. And this is all for real life things. You know what I'm saying? Like,
yeah.
This ain't a prep or a prop, you know what I'm saying? Like, I'm telling you actual facts. Like,
marketing campaign, you know what I mean?
These dudes come at us every day from all over the world, and they show us different things. And not only that, they buy shirts, they buy CDs, and they downloading YouTube videos, and they doing different things, and they singing our videos. Yo, it's just getting crazy. And then now we actually get to connect with them and see it. Yo, why not do it for them? There's a lot of people that really want to see the Flatliners win. You know what I'm saying?
Absolutely.
And they got Horrorcore magazine right now. We on the cover of Horrorcore magazine.
Oh,
Oh, dope.
Like, we on a cover of a magazine. Like, we got a lot of different things that's just been happening. And it's been happening on the strip for the fans because we ain't dropped no new music. We just dropped the unreleased and the re-release of the new CD with unreleased songs. But imagine when we actually drop that single, though. It's going to be crazy.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, yeah, absolutely.
Last night. I just laid my vocals for a new joint last night.
So you guys you guys got a whole new project in the works then coming.
Yeah, man. Yeah. We pulled in some of the old producers too. You know, we looking to get stuff from Rockwilder, TR Period, Shaw Skills and their Onyx first album.
Oh wow.
He did one of their hits. We got Eddie Chiba, we got tracks with me. Mm-hmm. We got tracks with me, Tempest and Red Rum, we producers too. So we got tracks from us. Yeah. And we have, who else do you have on there? I said Eddie Chiba, Rockwilder, Specialist, Jay World. Can't forget Jay World, the Specialist.
You can't forget
We got DJ Sage, he's going to set something up.
DJ Nice. Kid Nice with your other guy.
Kid Nice, yep.
Your other boy. Man, the one you just did the album with, Tim. What's that kid's name?
Yes.
Swift, we got him too. We got a team of producers, man. We got music out the head, like, you know, ready to do this.
We got producers, we got artists that we work with.
So we got artists, man.
We got a lot of things going on.
Yeah, you know, shout out to my artists, the Bad Guys.
Man,
you know, then we also have music that is not horror related.
Right. No, but you know what? Some dudes is dope.
Yeah, check out the Bad Guys, man. Free Sonny Black. Mm-hmm. He's doing a little skit, baby. He'll be home in a couple of months. Do a little parole violation. Sonny Black and Mello, the Bad Guys.
Actually, you got me.
He's gonna be torn with us.
You got me interested now, the Bad Guys. So, have they dropped anything, or is it just they're just kind of working on some shit?
Well, I have the mixtape. I have the album done. I'm just mixing it now.
Okay.
But, you know, I could set something up where I set up an interview with maybe Mello because, like I said, Sonny Black is doing a little. Doing a little parole violation.
Yeah.
So these real street dudes, you know what I'm saying?
Well, you know what? I would love to get them on, man, at some point. Yeah, absolutely.
By the way, okay. Things like parole violations and slashings and all that shit, that's just like regular type shit going on.
You know, that's shit. But, you know,
yeah,
before
so
you went
when we say my man locked up and he got parole violation, it's just
music,
like me saying, you know? I went to go get some teeth on the refrigerator.
Yeah. But before he went in, he got the album done, and he got his mixtape done. So I'll have to get you some music if you want, and
nice.
I set something up, and maybe for one of the other guys, partner, Mello, to come down or you know, to be on.
Cool. We can do that. Actually, I want to jump into another track right now, man. We're going to jump into Run. So
okay.
Here
we
go.
Love it.
We're gonna...
Produced by Cool T from the Afros.
Oh, okay.
Cool T and Crush, his partner was Crush.
Okay, all right. Run the Flatliners. So
time to time. See, I can flip with the words of what is preferred. I'm one strange bird. I talk like a talker truck, and when I fuck, I run them up. My animal magnetism always taking to bring it on. I put my knife back with your life, which you were never born. From a deep, dark dimension, should I be mentioned, not be legend. To the top, so to the depth, to fail my soul with vision. Pitching a fastball, he's taking a lead, and he's the with the second. Dive tracks packed fat like anthrax, so lyrics are rocking. Niggas that play they jump around my way, break, they can lynch them. Was that dream? I pinch them, put a red like an A-down. Central coming to get them, I'm running and doing up and down throughout the surface. Bringing a noise to hurt, cause I can die, so what's the purpose?
Run. That's a dope track, man. I love those sleigh bells in the back. Vintage.
Oh, yeah.
Vintage 94, man. Vintage old school. You know, put you back to MOP, Onyx, all those guys, man.
Yeah.
Hey,
shout
man.
Out to Cool T, man. Like I said, Cool T did that track.
MOP, you know what I'm saying? VR Period, one of our producers, he was the main producer for MOP at the time, too.
Wow.
Yes.
Man, that's
a... MOP.
You
that's
know,
our boys.
You know, I'm some dudes.
Yeah, shout out to Billy Dan and that boy Fame.
Some dudes I'm surprised you guys never. Some guys I'm surprised you never hooked up with was the Live Squad, man. Remember them?
Yeah, you're right.
In other words, I'm Heartless Dude.
We was working with the Bomb Squad. That's another person I'm gonna give a call to Hank Shockley and the Bomb Squad. They're responsible for Public Enemy, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah, Public Enemy, Cube, and all those dudes.
But they were definitely, Hank Shockley was very interested in doing some work with us for like 2 years, you know what I'm saying? He was calling me about Flatliners.
Yeah, definitely was. We had a meeting with him, too. We had a dinner. We had a sit-down meeting with him.
Hmm. How come it never materialized?
We definitely got to get back in contact with him, though.
How come it never materialized? Well, what happened?
Everything happens when it's supposed to happen. It just wasn't the time for it to happen then.
Right.
Yeah, the timing was off. So then the timing was
it
off.
Had to take exactly 20 fucking years. 94, 2014.
Wow.
You know what I'm saying? I would have sounded if it would have been 16 years. That's corny. You know what I'm saying? The universe ain't making it like that. The universe made it exactly 20 years.
Well now it's 21 years because it's 2015 now.
What?
That's 21
well,
years.
Well, now
we came back at 2014.
We came back in 2014. How it all started was, it's like right after our 20th anniversary, right after, I mean, like a day or two after Def Jam put USA on iTunes.
Oh.
Wow.
So Def Jam started reselling USA again on iTunes, and they put it back on their catalog. You can go to Def Jam and purchase USA. Or you can go to iTunes and purchase USA through Def Jam. So that was the first thing that happened. Like, oh, shit. And, yo, nigga, y'all know it was our 20th anniversary? And then after that, for some reason, things just started happening, shows and different things started popping up. So
now, you know, we just started. Do you guys get paid from those sales, man? Do you guys get paid from those iTunes sales now, or have they just kind of fucked you and taken your money? Oh, you do get paid?
No. We get residuals.
Oh, cool.
We do get resist. Well, to be honest with you, to be 100 with you, we don't know exactly right at this moment. We have our lawyer looking into, at this moment, how things operate pertaining to money that comes in from iTunes. Originally, you know what I'm saying, when they sell something, we get a residual. You know what I'm saying?
Hey, but this is great because you guys are street cats, but obviously you were smart enough to get a lawyer involved and you know the right things to do, you know?
No, of course. Well, yeah, you're street cats, but again, I'm Russell Simmons' fucking nephew, man. I'm not a fucking idiot.
Right.
Yeah, I'd be an idiot to not get a contract against my own uncle.
Yeah, we've been around the game before we got on. We was around every
now and again for a long time with different artists, so we already know.
I worked at Def Jam since I was 13 years old.
Oh wow!
So you know what I mean?
You know what? It's good though,
because
not a lot of
come through.
Not a lot of kids are savvy, man. Huh? Not a lot of cats are savvy in this kind of stuff, man. They're just happy to have a record deal, and then all of a sudden they're like, oh, shit, wait a minute. Publishing? What the fuck is this? You know, so
oh, yeah,
it's good you guys, you know, are on top of your shit, you know. It's restores, you know, definitely will make them think twice. You know what I mean?
Well, you learn quick or you burn dick. You yeah. Lord, nigga.
Well, you know, when your boy,
you know what I mean?
As your boy said, man, record industry people are shady.
Can't break it down no simpler than that.
What was that? You learn quick or you burn dick.
You learn quick or you burn dick. Be careful.
Hey, that's great. I'm gonna put that quote on my Facebook.
I just made that one up, by the way. I just made that one up just now. Never heard before, ever again. It's a straight Rev Rum original right now.
Wow.
Learn quick or you burn dick.
I see the t-shirt,
you know,
next week, baby.
Dude,
I'm going to...
Yeah, right, the t-shirt, kid,
FLM. I'm going to put that up on my Facebook, man. I'm going to quote you on my Facebook. I have a, you know, the section where they put quotes.
Please, man. Yeah, please just put my name under it. Red Rum or the Flatliners.
I will. Oh, I will. Trust me. Trust me. I will put your name on that shit. Man. That's,
I know some niggas out here going to be like, damn, there's going to be some people that's going to say, I relate, man. I relate.
I'm sure. I'm sure.
Dudes out here. You know what I mean?
Man, that's
you learn quick.
Well, you guys obviously have quite a following. Let me ask you this, because you started to follow me on Twitter, man. What made you find me out or search me out?
Flatliners are people.
We're some people. You know, I'm looking at people who are doing things, man. And you know, I think I was controlling the page that day. Grave Digger, and you know, sometimes I just scan through them, man, to see who's making moves and doing positive things.
Ah,
you know, thought you had a lot of money.
that you were wrong, but hey, but it's good, man. I'm glad that so obviously you did a little homework, you know, on Stim Radio, and you were like, hey, this dude is actually somebody we should have as a contact. So that's cool, man. I appreciate that. Appreciate that.
You know, I read some of the comments too, man. I see you didn't give a fuck with what you said. You was a real dude.
Oh yeah,
and I like that. I would like to be interviewed with somebody like that.
Oh, absolutely, absolutely.
You know, not somebody worried about what the fucking owner of the company saying, or you know, can I say this? Can we do this? You know, let's get on the motherfucking show.
Cursing.
Let's be real. Let's do this type of shows we need, because, like I
heard
said,
y'all cursing and I felt comfortable.
Oh yeah,
like I said before. This is the type of shit we want to do this for. Back in the days, it was none of this. It was when you go on the radio, they're like, "Oh no, you can't curse." They go, "Please," they used to beg us, "Please, man, I'm gonna get fired, man. Y'all gotta, y'all dudes is too fucking crazy, man. Y'all gotta fuck you."
You must be thinking. So, you must be thinking of the Bambino show. You must be thinking of
Tom right here.
What was the cat's name out there? Bambino or something like that. That a lot of you know. I know.
Oh, Bambino Garcia.
There you go.
That's my man.
Stretch on Bambino.
Yep.
Yeah. They true.
So
we grew up with Bambino. Bambino used to always come to the office. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. Oh.
Wow.
Very true.
That's history.
I remember we talking about fucking Ed Lover. What is it? Ed Lover show? The motherfucking Red Rum.
Oh, yeah.
Red Rum. You know, we was hood. We was young kids. So Red Rum was like, you know what I'm saying? You know what I'm saying? They had a bell.
Nah, it wasn't y'all saying. It was y'all mean.
Yo, yeah, y'all mean. You know, Red Rum was like, yo, y'all mean. And, you know, y'all mean. They kept hitting the bell. Bing.
You know, I was getting mad about that shit too. I was ready to do something to somebody.
He had the award. Red Rum had the award for
for a long time. Somebody, I think the RZA came and either I took the award from the RZA or he took it from me. One of us. We both up there, y'all meaning and shit to death. That's one thing that the Grave Diggers and the Flatliners got in common. Me and the RZA is y'all mean students and masters.
Well, it's funny.
Because
a lot of
masters,
cats,
you know what I'm saying, deities.
A lot of cats took that, though, man. I remember LL was doing it for a while, and a lot of people were starting to do it in their music. You know, it was almost like a sign of kind of an arrogance, you know what I'm saying, now when they took it. You know what I mean?
Oh, yeah. Hell, yeah. So, but, you know, that comes from out the streets, man. Guys just talking like that in their slang. It was just something smooth to do.
Right. Hey, but that's... What about L, man? You guys were on Def Jam. Did you ever, you know, talk with L about doing some shit, or was he in his own lane?
Well,
by the time we got around Def Jam, L was a motherfucking superstar.
Yeah.
L's place. You know what I'm saying? Early on, like I said, I've been around Def Jam since its inception. pretty much, you know what I'm saying? So he was around, and we've seen him and all that, but I don't really have too much of a connection with him. Through Run DMC, I had, the, you know, Uncle Joey and them was always doing shows with him, or he was around them sometimes. So through that, see him a little bit, but never really had no big major connection with LL.
Hmm. Yeah, I bumped into L one time at Def Jam Comedy. Yeah, he was a real cool dude, man.
I bumped into him several times. Yeah. Bumped into a lot of people. Shit, motherfucking Scarface, you know what I'm saying? Took us out to have drinks.
We met a lot of people. We just never got a chance to chop it up with him.
Just showed you Biggie.
Yeah, we just showed Public Enemy, man. They threw us on a couple of records.
We had so many bitches in our hotel room, or I should say Digga had so many broads in the hotel room that Biggie himself came in and asked, "Did we have something for sale in here?"
Oh shit.
You know what I'm saying? Not only that, because my uncle was Russell, I used to be able to miraculously get the best weed to other states easily.
Wow.
Other artists were not able to do that. So it always ended up that I always had the best weed,
man,
on tour. So all of the artists always had, you know, out of town, a lot of times, back in the days, when you go out of town and talk about out of town weed, you talk about garbage. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
It wasn't no dispensaries or any of that shit.
It was dirt.
You know what I'm saying? It was just dirt weed out of town. It wasn't popping at all.
Wow.
They used to give us that free garbage, and it gave us a headache.
Yeah. So we used to be on tour with the best. So Biggie and Redman and all those guys used to come to our hotel room and buy weed from us. And Digga was always the ladies' man. So he, you know what I'm saying? He would always coerce the ladies into the hotel room, many of them.
So he was bringing the hoes around.
I hope your girl or your wife don't hear this.
Whoops.
Get tonight, man.
Hey, but you know what? But that's old shit, man. Obviously, you can't expect him to, you know. That was stuff he did years ago, man. You can't hold him accountable for something.
Yeah, man.
Oh, you'd be surprised, though. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
You'd be surprised what could get held against you.
Shit comes back.
Yeah. But it's all good,
man. Well, you know, I know you guys got a connection with Eric Sermon. You guys, you know, did some shit with Eric Sermon.
Yeah, Eric Sermon's our boy. Whole Def Squad.
That's
whole Def Squad.
Yeah,
we got connection. Not only Eric Sermon, Parrish is like family. You know what I'm saying? EPMD, both.
Now those dudes,
his squad. Dig was just talking to Keith Murray not too long ago.
We're
talking about Keith Murray about a joint for this album, man. Hopefully he goes
through. We're trying to get Keith Murray on the new Flatline album. So we're working on that as well.
That's a name I haven't heard in a minute.
Well, that should be a problem.
So that's a name I haven't heard in a minute, Keith Murray.
Murray. He's still dope,
the
man.
Legendary, man. Keith Murray.
Legend, man.
Man, you know what I ultimately want to do, too, man? I want to do an Us versus Them album. You know what I mean? I want to do an album with all of us old school 90s dudes, man. Smith & Wesson, Onyx, let's get them, get M.O.P., let's get, you know what I mean? Let's
get
all those dudes.
Facts up in there too,
let's
man.
Get all those dudes into an album, dude. It's an album against these new dudes. That's what I would like, dude. I would love to do that, I swear.
Oh, come on, man.
You demolish
them, man. You tear them apart.
It'd be crazy.
Man, that's
all they'll be able to talk about is we got a lot of money. I don't give a fuck about your money, nigga. You had to do things to get that. You know what I mean? I'm good.
So who?
We already seen that money, nigga. Like, what you talking about? We seen money.
Yeah, it's not even about money, dude. That shit is corny, dude. If your life is all about money and materials, that shit is whack, nigga.
But like
my
you said,
about
our album
people.
That shit, we destroyed a new era, man.
Yeah,
so we definitely got put
all
together
guys
something that looked like that.
Redman.
Oh, God, man,
Method Man. Smash the new era.
You know what, though, man? See, here's the other problem I find with the new era, man, is you don't, like your stuff, when we listen to your album, we know we're listening to some New York cats. Now you listen to somebody from New York, you think you might be listening to somebody from Atlanta or from, you know, somewhere like that, you know?
Because see, back in the days, man, you couldn't come out sounding like nobody. You would get dissed. You would get snatched off the stage. All that.
If you was whack back in the days, you couldn't come out in New York. If you was whack, you wouldn't get shot in New York.
you couldn't rock.
Man.
Now,
man, yo, in
now
New
the
York,
thing is, if you don't
man, we used to walk around looking for people to battle, man. Don't ever be caught in the street just rhyming or whatever, because I'm going to approach you. Wherever I'm going to approach you and ask you, are you rap? What up? Let's battle. That's how I used to be. Word to everything I love. Everywhere I went, I battled people. That's just what we did.
And Hot Wax.
Man.
I used to have classic battles in Hot Wax.
Hey, Tempest used to work in an actual a legendary record store. You know what I'm saying? With a bunch of DJs, where all the DJs went to go get their wax, Hot Wax. On Jamaica Avenue is where we started, when music was about something. You know what I'm saying? You had to actually go to a fucking record store to get the new joint out. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. To get the new exclusive joint out, to get a mixtape in it. That wasn't no internet. You know what I'm saying? You couldn't get it in your living room. You had to go get it. You had to deliver. And previously before that, niggas was putting tapes back together.
Oh, shit. You mean where you take the tape apart and pull the tape apart
and you put it back together.
Oh, wow.
We was doing that. So that's the generation where we come from.
Oh, man.
I come from a generation where we carried a boombox. You know what I'm saying? We had boombox inside the graveyard. I got pictures of me still with Dredd Rum with a boombox. You know what I'm saying?
Wow.
On the steps of right in front of the Digger Crib, right in front of the Digger Crib with a boombox. Me and my nephew, who looked like he's 2 at the time. Now he's a grown dude.
Man, that's...
But you know what I mean?
That's crazy.
Boombox.
With a boombox. Man, you took me back talking about taking the screws out of a tape. Holy shit.
Yeah.
you remember
my brother used to be a master at that, kid. Because you wasn't going to let that tape go because you had red alert on there.
Oh, yeah.
I used to DJ, so I used to DJ also. So I used to take that shit apart because I had to fix it. You know, you put it in your pocket or you put it in somebody's tape deck and they chew your tape up.
They get all twisted and crazy.
Chew your shit up.
Man, I used to be a master at that shit, kid.
Yeah, I used to push the word up. So you right push up. The middle part of the tape up so that shit play louder.
Wow.
This is science. This is science of the rap gods right here.
This is great, man. I'm loving
science
this shit.
Science of the rap gods.
I love it.
You give a kid a tape right now, they'll look at that shit like, man, they don't know what it is.
And they just go right to Walmart and get some duct tape or some tape. You don't know nothing about no tape.
Possibly bubble tape.
No more. You know what I'm saying?
Give them a tape. They're bubble tape. Give them a kid a tape right now. They probably try to stick their headphones in that shit.
Like it's a bad electronic device. Wow.
They got iPods that's smaller than the tape.
Wow.
You know what I mean?
Dude, that's awesome. Well, you know, I want to get into another track, man. This is, what's over there, man? Be Like Us? What's the track?
Oh.
I'll Be Down. I'll Be Down. It's I'll Be Down. That's what it is. So we're going to
jump. Yeah.
Eric Sermon joint.
Ah, yes.
Eric Sermon joint.
Eric Sermon. All right, let's jump into this, and we'll be right back to talk to you some more.
From heat waves in my brain, I've slain. I went buck fool like Burger King on the train. I was an assassin, but assassins now. I'm catching the lethal and catching no fear. It's my protection. Any pressure can't be the death of me. I keep it real. And I keep a pack of CDs from here. Everything is uphill. It's flatline massive. The scenes get ugly. A hunchback short nigga like Muggsy tried to pluck me. I'm action packed like an Arnold Schwarzenegger film. Horror like Hellraiser, hard like above the rim. Slim, only obey one thing at a time. And if it ain't me, let it be my rhyme. I'm here now, but I teleport like Brayton. My body starts vibrating when a reptile's invading. My heart is cool, I'm on the hole like an X-Men pump. My crew don't have to duck when I jump up and grab some. You know you entered the wrong time and the wrong land. My lyrical get down make you sound like a single man. I'm a wild sabotaging, cuckoo, suck a tash, I'll bash. It'll be an eclipse to the moon if you zoom into my cash.
You be down to die, it's the flatliners. You be down to die, I be down to die. You be down to die. It's the flatliners. You be down to die. We be down to die. We be down to die. We the flatliners. Heaven isn't as
high as I am, so you find us up in the pits of hell. Hear me well, hell's physics. We see low in 666 or dice digits. When they roam, they'll do as the demons do or be damned. Master of the unknown, poems known to no man. Red rum will flow like blood. The paranormal being will be inside on Jay's crib with some gloves on. Lasses to black bastards. They worry, we represent caskets and blast devils to ashes. Flatline massive, feminine like Waco, Texas. When I rap, my ass knows best to hack reckless. Hell bent for fright, man, and phantom like. Nigga by day, you wolf by night, who like fighting. You be down to die, I ain't down for pounds of pain. You be found on A-Train tracks, slain me, mean this.
Put it on our SoundCloud page, and then they took it off.
I'm telling you, man. My that line, I forgot about that. My lyrical get down and make you sound like Encino, man. Oh, some Pauly Shore word. Shit.
Word, Encino, man. He's a caveman.
I like them
right?
Dudes, son. They appreciate lyrics, you know what I mean?
Hell yeah.
Man, dude, that
I'm
is.
I'm thinking about that shit.
Because I'm thinking, you know, I saw that movie years ago, man, and dude is, yeah, buddy. You know, I don't know.
He was a caveman, right?
Right. He brought him out from
Encino
the
Man. That was Brendan Fraser.
Right.
Yeah, they found him out the fucking
from the swimming pool.
They found him in a block of ice mummy. And shit like that.
It was a swimming remember? Pool. Yeah, it was a swimming pool that he had drained. Yep. Remember?
Dummy mummy.
Man, but yeah, that shit is dope, man. So Eric Sermon produced that track, huh?
Yeah.
Nice. That's another dude I have to get on here at some point, man, or get both of them, him and Parrish, on together. I don't know if they're still working together, but, you know.
Yeah, I think they're working on a new album now. I think I got wind of that. So.
Oh, okay. Okay. Yeah, man, I might have to get at you later, Digga, about that. But now, you know, we're like at the last 10 minutes of the interview, man, so this is the time to, you know, any information you want people to know, you know, like your Facebooks, your Twitters, where people could buy your music, anything you want them to know, man, this is the time to spit it.
Okay.
Well, definitely we want you to go to our website. It's theofficialflatliners.com. Officialflatlinerswithaz.com. And our Facebook is The Flatliners. You search us with The Flatliners. Twitter, The Flatliners. Instagram, The Flatliners. And we have a graveyard team, too. Flatliners Graveyard Team on Facebook. You know, anybody that want to join our street team, we got like 150 guys already down, people from all over the world that's supporting the movement, that's going to push all our posts and CDs or anything we send out to them. They're going to push it all over their communities and countries or city.
You know what, dude? Shout out to that real quick. I just got to say, my boy Bloodflow is part of your graveyard team. And as a matter of fact,
oh man, yeah, definitely is.
He wrote me.
To be honest with you,
he wrote me,
you
man.
Know, I like the concept of the graveyard team. You know what I'm saying? It's basically a way to include fans and ourselves, give us more of a contact and something to be together about. You know what I'm saying? And work together for. You know what I'm saying? We give incentive. We send out our graveyard team. Well, we will be sending them merchandise, free merchandise, and different incentives for working with us and running with us. You know what I'm saying? It's just family.
That's
when we do shows, when we start touring all over the world, and these guys, those guys that's members, they're going to be coming on the set with us. They're doing videos. They're going to be there. They're going to be backstage with us, taking pictures and eating and everything with us when we're in the area. So, you know, we're going to give back to those guys that's supporting the movement like that.
Man, you know what?
Those guys are family.
It was funny because Bloodflow wrote me. It was, I want to say it was this past Saturday. And he was like, dude, I'm on the street team for the Flatliners. Why don't you have them on your show? And I was like, dude, actually, that's funny because that's in the works. So, you know, little did he know, hey, guess what?
The universe. That's how the universe is.
That's what's up.
Man, so you know Bloodflow, he's on your street team. He's pushing, man. He's pushing. You could tell.
Yeah, so. I see, man. I see the work you're putting in. His family, too. Like, he got brothers and stuff, too, don't he, that do music?
He probably does, man, yeah. He probably does. Like, his
brother,
buddies,
I think, is
Horror Flick Music and those guys?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, he got a team, man. Shout out to those guys, Bloodflow and his family, man. They definitely supporting the movement. Man. And we're going to support those guys, too, when they start doing their thing.
Cool, yeah.
Another thing, too, about us, the Graveyard Team, anybody that's on our Graveyard Team, and or that's with us, we're always trying to help push their projects along as well, however we could contribute to their projects as well. You know what I'm saying? This ain't a one-way street.
Man, so, and there will be a new Flatliners album drop in 2015, right?
Yes, it will.
Absolutely.
Cool, cool. And that's, what's that going to be called? What's the name of the project?
We haven't titled it yet.
Oh, okay.
I came up with some ill stuff that I'm going to present to the guys, and then we're going to all see if they like it. But not only are we doing Flatliners album, we're doing the FLM album, too, which is going to be guys that's affiliated with us, an album with those guys. Hardcore guys and guys that's not hardcore, all mixture. That's family, you know, FLM album.
Man.
So I don't know, I'm not sure if that's going to come out this year or beginning of next year, but, you know, I'm trying to get both of these albums done for this year. Well, we're trying to get both of these albums done
for this year. I'm thinking the FLM album should be a mixtape, Dig, first.
So that's...
We'll talk about that, you know what I'm saying? Yeah. That should come along with the Flatliner album. Or precursor to the Flatliner album.
Well, you know, we're going to see how we're going to do this. We got tons of options. Cause like I said, we're controlling our own show. So that's the beauty of it.
So it's for people want to stay up on you, man, the main place they need to be at is the official Flatliners with a Z
.com. With a Z.
Right.
.com.
That's cool. Right.
Man.
Because they have the links to everything. Yeah, you can go to, you can order shirts. And you can, like I said, you can order that. The CD, the 20th anniversary CD, you can order that there. You can order the Hardcore magazine, Flatliners on the cover of Hardcore magazine. I guess you can order that from there, too.
Man.
You can also go see the allhiphop.com interview and listen to how they try to fuck us over.
Yeah, you can see that, too.
One thing my Uncle Russell always taught us was that good press or bad press is all good press.
Man, so, yeah, I just...
You know what I mean? For that.
That's, wow. Just too bad they had to twist your words around, man. That's, you know, kind of bitch shit. That's why we're kind of against shit like that. You know what I'm saying?
Well, when bitches gossip about you, you must be a pimp.
And that's
you
true.
Know what I mean? So.
That's true. Man, Red Room is full of quotes tonight, man. You know? You
got quote the rum.
Must be.
If they want to talk to us,
look, never more quote the rum.
What'd you say if they want to talk to you?
We want to shout out some of our people too, man. Butter, my boy Bloody Stud, man. He's mad, man. He's coming. Shout out for the videos. Huh?
If they want to get at us day to day, get at us on Facebook because then you'll talk to us direct.
Okay.
Definitely. Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter.
Man, all the social networks.
Get at us on this. You'll talk to one of us direct.
Man.
The Flatliners. Everything is the Flatliners.
Flatliners with a Z.
Twitter, the Flatliners. Instagram, the Flatliners.
Man.
Right.
That's what's up. So any last shout outs, man, before we get rolling? We're gonna jump into one more track before we go. But
yeah, man, I want to give a shout out to Butter, these old Flatliners, Butter.
There's a brother, that's right, Poisonous Butter.
New Flip, Mellow, Sunny Black, J World. Flatline from Camp Crystal Lake. That's my boy, too, man, out of Buffalo. There's a group called Camp Crystal Lake.
My man, Dead on Dick. My man,
Reese.
Yeah,
we got my man, Eddie Chiba, Rockwilder.
Eddie Chiba. That's right. That's my boy.
I want to shout out Onyx.
Shout out to my boy, Rockwilder, my brother.
Rockwilder's birthday just passed the other day. I want to give him a happy birthday, Rockwilder.
E-Swift, Skid, Roe, DR period, Shot Skills. That's everybody, man. Everybody who represents.
I want to give shout outs to all FLM, my boy Toss, you know what I'm saying? Locked up. I want to give shout outs to my boy Otto out here, his brother Byron, you know what I mean? All my dudes from St. Mark's, my whole 50-50 clique, my whole 50-50 family on the uprise, my brother Khalif. Khalif and Omen, man, they've been shouting Flatliners since before we was a rap group, you know what I'm saying? They still shout Flatliners 20 years later every day.
Wow.
You know what I'm saying? They diehard Flatline fans.
Well, you know what, man?
It's a bit...
You guys, well, I appreciate you guys coming on, man, spending 2 hours with us. That's really cool. And we're gonna.
We're trying to come back too.
Enjoy ourselves, man.
Oh, you definitely.
Enjoy ourselves, man. Y'all some cool dudes, man.
Definitely, man.
We have fun.
We want you guys back.
Enjoy. We get the Skype video. We get the Skype thing going on, man. Hopefully.
Oh yeah, yeah, yeah. Because of the weather, we couldn't do that because you guys couldn't really meet up. You know what I mean? So. That's
right.
We will do it again. So keep us up on what projects you're going to be, you know, doing and what you want to push. And we're going to jump into one more track, man. It's Like Us.
All right.
So, man, thanks again. And we'll talk to you soon.
All right.
Peace, man. Thanks a lot, man. Y'all have a good night, man.
Yep. You too.
Don't let the werewolves bite.
Thank y'all for the love. I'm
who don't care where the fuck you live. When your bell rings, you know who the fuck it is. The three-headed, ten-horned beast of destruction lives in. We talk a lot of shit, but our funds is long and our guns are big. And we be rolling with tons of niggas. Everybody dressed black when the fun begins. We're the sons of sin, we've come to win. Ain't no losing when you win. If you against us, call your men's. Better two-way all your friends and tell them. We'll crack open your cerebellum for that bullshit that you was yelling. We gonna show who the illness is, who the Grim Reaper's children is.
Come on.
These other niggas ain't made like us. On the grind, any day, getting paid like us.
Uh-huh.
These niggas don't play like us. Mr. Diesel in the haze and blaze like us.
Woo.
Nobody flip a phrase like us and spit flames out of hell on a stage like us.
Uh-huh.
Ain't nothing you can say to us. Bitch, niggas, you should pray to
our Father, are you heaven?
Niggas like Red Rum, you done lost your wig. Cause I'm on the Ouija board trying to talk the big. We the niggas that built this shit. Horrorcores, Masons did it brick by brick. Spit so sick, 666 is how we flip those scripts. Who do voodoo just to get those chips? Y'all niggas can't fit those shoes. We break all rules and take y'all jewels. We don't need them, but we hate y'all fools. Y'all shall soon meet y'all doom. We them dudes that do it from the womb to the tomb. Morbid, disgusting, distorted. DVS, murderous recordings. The earth is hell and we report it. How we see the world is how we call it. These other niggas ain't made like us. On the grind, ain't they getting paid like us.
Uh-huh.
These niggas don't play like us. Mr. Diesel in the haze and plays like us.
Woo!
Nobody flip a phrase like us and spit flames out of hell on a stage like us.
Uh-huh.
Ain't nothing you can say to us. Bitch niggas, you should pray to us.
God, Father, who art in heaven, please keep these monkey-ass, crazy motherfucking niggas, the flatliners, from out of my circumference. These niggas is crazy. The niggas be saying some unholy shit.
Unholy shit, bitches. I'm Maxwell Silverhammer.
GJ just sat here and did a fucking nothing all night long.
Right on. What's that different from any other time?
I know. What the hell?
And that's the story there, bitches. See ya.
It's the shit.